Welcome to Lifelong Running, the channel where we break down the science to help you run smarter, faster, and injury-free. Today we're going to focus on footstrike and running and help you understand what is out there in terms of myths and also what the science says about whether you should be a heel striker, midfoot striker, forefoot striker, or what. Let's start with the basics of how we define footstrike. It depends which article you're looking at, which website you might be on, but I'm going to stick with one convention for today, and that is where we have the heel striker, the midfoot striker, where the midfoot touches first, but the heel still does come down and touch the ground at some point, and then the forefoot striker, where midfoot or forefoot touches first, but the heel never touches the ground. We'll often just classify in a lot of articles as heel strike or non-heel strike. Differences that we see between heel strikers and non-heel strikers are a shorter time on the ground for the non-heel strikers. There was some question about whether stride rate and length are different between heel and midfoot strikers or heel and non-heel strikers. And the first articles showed that heel strikers tended to have a little bit lower stride rate with longer strides. But those first studies were looking at runners where they self-selected their speed. Not everyone was doing the same thing. And more recent studies and others still around that time, or a larger quantity of studies anyway, where running speed was fixed across people, they found that there's no difference between heel strike and non-heel strike runners in terms of their turnover, the stride rate, or the stride length. Now, it doesn't mean someone might have a longer or shorter stride than somebody else, but on average, the type of foot strike doesn't seem to be influencing that. Another factor that comes across is peak force that we feel. As we hit the ground, the force of the ground pushing back on us rises to a peak and drops back down. When we hit that peak as a heel striker, we tend to have a little bit greater peak force that occurs compared to the midfoot striker. But you might think, well, that means if we become a midfoot striker, a little less injury risk. But one of the recent studies that took a look at changing from heel to midfoot found those runners did not change in their peak force. So there's a lot of uncertainty, a lot of things that we're still learning, and I'd advise you to be cautious in deciding whether you should try to switch foot strike from one to the other. So overall, the bulk of the studies say there's not any difference in performance and running economy between the heel striker and the non-heel strikers. And if you switch from one to the other, then there seems to be no benefit. And there's one other article out there that also found if you do switch, it actually hurts your running economy. Now, long-term changes might be something to consider, but there is also one out there that did an 8-week training cycle where people in a heel strike group and a non-heel strike group flipped and did the opposite type of running for 8 weeks, came back and did the same testing of heel strike and non-heel strike for both groups, and overall found that when you switch, you're going to be worse off. And even if you extend that training through 8 weeks, there was still no benefit. They did better when they just stuck with what their preferred movement patterns were. Now, if we look just at the true elite runners, I've got some images here representing the, I think it was 2017, 10K at the US Championships, and have images of the men and the women where we see their left and right feet at the instant they first touch the ground. I was wondering here as I filmed these and then cropped the images out, whether there would be a clustering of midfoot strikers or heel strikers at the front or back of the field. And as you can see from this, it's pretty spread out. There's a scattering of people mixed all around. So the articles say there's really no difference in performance between foot strike types. And these images tell me there's a spread of them throughout. So if there is anything connected with performance and foot strike, it seems there's other factors that matter a whole lot more. When we consider injury, there's also a whole lot of articles out there that have some mixed opinions and data leaning one way or the other. If you take all of the literature together, you'll find a few that say there's some issues with heel striking, there's some issues with non-heel striking, and the majority of articles in the middle show that there's really no difference in injury rates between heel strikers and non-heel strikers. Let's look at a few of these and consider what the findings were. When we consider the first three studies here, we have groups of 471, 1,203, and another study with 341 runners that found no differences in injury rates between the different foot strike groups. However, Kleindienst and Walter found there are some differences in the locations of the injuries. An overall summary of their article combined with some others is that heel strikers tend to have injuries knee and above, where midfoot and forefoot strikers tend to have injuries below the knee. Now, that does not mean a heel striker will never get a foot injury or an Achilles issue, or a midfoot striker won't get a problem in their hip or knee, but the tendency goes that way. So total injury rates equal between groups, locations of injuries does tend to vary a little bit. And that's where I wonder, maybe there is some benefit to shifting foot strike for a time when you're dealing with recovering from a certain injury. We can take some stress off of certain areas of the body by changing foot strike. However, the trouble there is if we take some stress off of one location, we're probably going to be adding some stress to another location that might cause a different issue. So when someone does want to make a modification in foot strike related to injury, I encourage them to get onto a soft surface, slow the pace just a little bit as they work through this rehabilitation time, and as they shift the locations of the stresses by modifying foot strike, there might be some benefit there, but the focus should be primarily on good treatment to take care of the injury and modifying forces in some way. I would prefer, rather than changing foot strike, just getting onto different surfaces, changing the speeds of running. If you have the ability, then get on something like a Boost treadmill or Ultra G treadmill, HydroWorks, where your body weight is elevated either by air pressure or by moving through a fluid like water. One last article to consider that kind of takes this whole idea into one. Melcher in 2016 looked at shifting from one foot strike to another and found that we are capable of placing different amounts of load on the joints of our body when we do shift our foot strike. However, he also found that the energy cost of running rose when we did switch from one to the other. So overall, I'd encourage you to not change your foot strike for performance or injury reasons, focus on the traditional methods of recovering from injuries and preventing injuries as the primary factor there. And for performance, it seems whenever a change is made in foot strike, we end up having a worse situation in the end. I hope this has been of some value to you to see what the articles are out there saying in terms of foot strike and can take some of the ideas you may have heard online that aren't necessarily true and focus on what you can do to improve your performance. I'd encourage you just to be gradual in your adaptations as you train, focus on getting really fit through the running that you do, and for now, leave foot strike the way your body wants to do it.